Hello. Hi. Hello. Hello. Yeah, okay. I think I will just welcome everyone. Welcome to Bari Kothi. This is my first live on the Bari Kothi channel. I'm trying to get used to this whole technology, which is quite wonderful. Rana Safvi, who is our special guest, with whom we'd love to have a conversation, understand. I've just sent her the request. We're trying to connect that. Hi, Ms. Safvi.
Hi, hello, how are
Hi, Darshan Dudhoria. Pleasure to have you on board.
Nice to meet you. Thank you.
Likewise, nice to e-meet you because this is the new world, apparently.
Yes,
And to
it
be honest, I'm loving this. I'm loving this than anything before because I'm ending up meeting wonderful people such as yourselves and so many other people that I would never otherwise get a chance to.
And that's been the same with
So
me, that
let
I,
me.
because of the conversations, I've met wonderful people, I've held wonderful conversations myself, and it's been a very enriching experience.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, just to introduce everyone who's here, we've got Mrs. Rana Safvi, who is a where do I start? A writer, a historian, amongst other things, loves conservation, loves heritage, of course, and then she's authored this beautiful. I love the name of your book, by the way, Where Stones Speak. And I for whatever reason, enjoy my philosophy also. And once my colleague Divya, who was who was supposed to come on air with you. So once she mentioned that you were coming on, I thought that let us not make this an interview and let it just be a wonderful discussion, because I would love to know about your books. I would love to. I saw one of your blogs had the most beautiful where you've spoken about your family and your family history. And I saw this one picture, a beautiful hookah, a beautiful attire. And the jewelry that was there, it was like I was just, I'm getting goosebumps when I say that to you, because I have very, very similar pictures of our forefathers in Murshidabad in everything but the hookah. So it's just amazing. So we are extremely happy to have you on board. And just to
Thank
introduce
you.
ourselves and just to let you know about myself also, Bari Kothi is a very interesting project that we started in Murshidabad. We are about 5 hours from Calcutta, and our entire our palace was built around the 1774. And since then, obviously, different parts of the building kept getting constructed. So it was for the last, I think, 60 odd years, we were completely locked down, and everything was falling apart. And which is where we realized that it's important to save that heritage. My two beautiful daughters, they'll at least get a get an idea of what the family used to be and what heritage did they grow up with. So we started this humble thing of restoring our building, and today we are at a stage where we've ended up not only saving the building, but we've started the first luxury heritage hotel of the region in Murshidabad. Our core values have been about community. Everyone who's in our project are all local community members, essentially unskilled farmers who all come on board. And we've been now typically traveling all over the world, trying to spread the word, trying to get everyone back to Murshidabad. And you must be aware, Murshidabad contributed 5% of the GDP of the world. So with that entire heritage, we wanted to start this. And now I'm definitely not saving it for my daughters, but I'm giving them something far more difficult to manage and take on and pass on forward to their future generations. So that's Bari Kothi, and I've been lucky enough, and I'm the seventh generation to my greatest grandfather, who didn't create and build Bari Kothi, but brought it to its I think peakest glory. That's what we understand from a lot of history books. So that's us. I would request you to tell us a little bit about yourself, Delhi, books, historian, writer, too much going on.
Thank you so much. And when I came to Murshidabad, to begin with that, I saw some palaces which were locked up. I'm Good. Talking of inside the city. And I felt so sad when I saw them, especially one, I'm forgetting the name now, but it was beautiful with a temple at the back. And, you know, I felt so sad. I said, all these, you know, palaces, which must have seen so much at once, at one time. And they just locked up and just, you know, so it's so sad. So I'm glad that you're doing this project. And that heritage has been a passion for me ever since I think I remember. And I did my master's in history from Aligarh Muslim University. After that, I was teaching history, and I've been living in the Gulf a lot. So it was while in the Gulf, I think when you are far away from your heritage, that you start appreciating it even more.
Pattern.
And when I was there is when I suddenly realized that there's so much that we need to preserve, we need to talk about. And you started much younger than I did. I started at age 55. I decided to start writing about. I'd been blogging and I'd been doing a lot of other things before that. But the thought of writing a book came to me in 2013. And Delhi was something that pulled me to it. And so I decided that the first book I would write. And not only first, I've written 6 books on Delhi so far.
Wow.
One set is a trilogy, which is Where Stones Speak. That's the entire
Tell me a little bit about, because the name is just, it just gets this sparkle in my eye. Where Stones Speak, because then you're pretty much capturing the stories that typically would not be found in history books. And who better than a history teacher and a history student to write about that? Tell me a little bit about your book, please.
See, I do is that I take a monument. Let's say I have taken the Red Fort. Now, The Red Fort is not only the stones and bricks, the stones and marble or whatever it is. There's so much that happened inside it. And there is a lot of documented history of what happened inside the Red Fort, how the Red Fort was built. So when I'm describing Diwane Khas inside the Red Fort, so then I describe not only how the building was built, how Shah Jahan went about it, when it was inaugurated, you know, the foundation laid, and etc., but I also describe the events that take place inside that. And for all that, I do a lot of research from the Persian sources. Persian is an ongoing project. I'm still learning it. But I take English translations from authors whom I know who have done good work. And apart from that, there is a lot written in Urdu, which from where I take my stories. And the history books that I have. So
tell us something interesting, which is not something that I would read in a history book, or something interesting about the Red Fort, or one of those interesting facts, rather. I would call it a fact, because stones are speaking here.
So I also feel that, you know, these stones can speak, and this is what they saw. And so I'm just the storyteller for this, about their story. But my story is all based on facts and research and from historical documents. So, for example, this my latest book is Shah Jahanabad, The Living City of Old Delhi. Now, in that, there is this very famous verse, Agar Firdaus Barru-e Zameen Ast, Hame Ast Toh Hame Ast Toh Hame Ast. Now, people say that this was...
You'll have to repeat that slower.
Okay.
I didn't catch that.
Agar Firdaus Barru-e Zameen Ast, Hame Ast Toh Hame Ast Toh Hame Ast. If there is a paradise on earth, it is here, it is here, it is here.
Oh, wow.
This is written on the arches of the Diwane Khas in Red Fort.
Okay.
Now, I remember the first time I went to the Red Fort must have been about 40, 50 years ago. When I went there, the guy told us, you know, that this is something that Jahangir had said when he went to Kashmir. And that is what most people believe, that this is said by Jahangir when he went to Kashmir, and so Shah Jahan has replicated it on his wall. But when I started studying and I started researching, I found that it is very far from the truth. It has nothing to do with Jahangir at all. So there are two theories which I have discussed in my book. One is that most historians feel that it was said by Hazrat Amir Khusro. Now, Persian scholars say that this is not present in any of his divans. And his Farsi, jitna unka kalam hai, or his Farsi verse, or his Persian verse, has all been documented. So, they say it is not present in any of his work. So if he did say it, why is it not present? And why would he say just offline, you know, just one couplet? There should have been an entire either a ghazal or a nazam or whatever it is that he would have written on it. So, when I started searching further, then I found there's this book on Delhi, which has been, which is one of the seminal books of on Delhi in Urdu. It's written by Maulvi Bashiruddin Ahmed, who was working with the ASI. And he's written this three-volume, very fat book called Waqiyat-e Darul Hukumat Delhi, or The Events of the Capital of Delhi. He's written it in 1911. So when he writes it, he says that, you know, this verse was written by Sadullah Khan, who was the supervisor, the wazir of Shah Jahan, and the one who was supervising the construction. So now there are these two contradictory facts. One is the people think it's written by the Amir Khusro. And I tracked this verse to a manuscript in the National Museum, written around the same time as when the fort was made, but a little time around the time when Shah Jahan was ruling, by a nephew of Shah Jahan and his librarian called Tahir Khan Ashna. So I heard that, you know, like somebody said this verse is written by him. Now there are references in various books that when Shah Jahan came into the fort, he invited poets to say, you know, like verses in praise of this heaven on earth. So, and it's the Red Fort has been conceived as a paradisical theme. It's made with the Nehre Bahesh, and you know, like it's made like supposed to be a heaven on earth. So,
just to understand that correctly, you're saying Red Fort was idealized or envisioned to be a heaven on earth, and that was the entire thought process with which it was built.
Yes, it is on the paradisical theme, and you with the, you know, the streams running through it, you have a Nehre Bahish there, it's an irregular octagon. So these are things which were taken, and you have lot of water, but of course you have park, gardens, etc., etc. When I heard this from a Persian scholar, professor, that Tahir Khan Ashna has written it. So I went to the National Museum with a lot of difficulty. We finally managed to find this 17th century manuscript. So in that, he said, you know, we found the verse. And when we found the first, we kept looking for Kashmir. You know that if it's written on Kashmir, we would find it. So we kept hunting for it. Now, when we didn't find anything in the Kashmir, the Masnavi that is written on Kashmir. But then we suddenly found this verse. And, you know, I was thrilled. I said, okay, we found the author, the poet who has written these lines. But then he says that as Amir Khusro has written, this place is a Agar Firdaus Barru is a Venus. So it turns out that
just
it has been written by.
Correct. And just imagine the labor. In this part of the world, we call it labor of love. That the amount of labor that you would take to take out one of these, I wouldn't say an answer, but some amount of logic or rationale in something interesting that you would see written on a stone. Because I think that is what is glorious, and not a lot of people understand that very part. Because I think history to me, so I grew up as a lawyer. And in fact, I understand numbers very well. And I spent almost 7-8 years practicing law. And suddenly when I got exposed to this particular project, is where heritage or culture or all of these things, humanity rather. So we've got this very interesting foundation, which I'll tell you, which is in fact called these HHH, which is heritage, hospitality and humanity. So the whole idea is people who've got old houses, we've taken all this trouble to, you know, over a period of 5 years, we had a mad Canadian architect who signed up for this project, who felt we've caged him and not allowing him to go back till he finishes the project. So we did all of that, and we realized that a lot of people would struggle in the same manner that we have. And the idea was to create that platform. And for me, the biggest challenge which continues for the project is exactly what you said about finding the intangible assets of the house. So we've got all of these beautiful. So essentially, our community is called the Sheherwalis. So we moved in from Rajasthan to Bengal, and we were ruled by the Mughal kings then, the Mughal Nawabs rather. and then the British East India Company was almost getting into reached its glory. So at that point in time, obviously a lot of wealth was getting created in Murshidabad, and we as a society started imbibing a lot of these influences. So we would have a lot of, so our cuisine, although we are Jains by religion, our cuisine is purely vegetarian, which has a lot of Mughal influence and has a lot of Bengal influence, apart from at the heart being Rajasthani. So which is again very interesting. And the same thing, why I mentioned this to you, is the same thing I find in a lot of our documents also. So extremely old documents that we see, some of them are written in Urdu, some, and I can't, to be honest, distinguish between Urdu and Farsi and all, you know, that particular, those set of languages. Some people say it's a different dialect or a style of writing Bengali, which now is more towards the Dhaka side and hasn't got its influence more towards Calcutta. So it's, I think that is the biggest challenge. And our, I think, 2020 and 2021 would be fully dedicated for us, at least, to find all these old stories. We're trying to do a coffee table book amongst all our old families to try and narrate their history, get out their old manuscript. I would love for you to look at them and possibly, because you need someone as mad as, I think, people, and I'm taking the liberty of not joining the club, but saying people like us, where it just goes completely, there is no rationale. You can't pinpoint, because I don't know what return also we'd get or what's going to happen.
So, as you said, there's that it's irrational. My love for heritage, my love for what people see as ruins is, when I'm exploring, and because I write on monuments, so I do a lot of explorations. When I'm exploring, I challenge myself. I do not see whether it's hot or whether it's, cold. I just go out there. And for me, it is, I'm here, I must see everything that there is in it. I suffer from vertigo, yet I climb up to the top of the highest, whatever the building is. And then when I'm coming down, I have to sit and, negotiate each step because I can't stand and come down. But it doesn't deter me. And this is something I think that comes from passion for your work. And as I said, I'm very passionate about that. And I remember once, two places. One was in Daulatabad Fort, where I climbed up to the top of the flagstaff and I had to sit and come down. And another was in the Red Fort Bauli, where I was, so I climbed up, and then when I started coming down, I felt I'm going to fall. So I just froze. And there were these two people with me. So they then helped me, like one at the back, one in front. And they literally brought me down because there was no railing or banister, obviously. So for me, that is sometimes my vertigo kicks in. But then I don't let it worry me. I just feel that I have to do it, whether it's hot, whether I'm, in 45 degrees. In summers, I have done exploring. Because whatever needs to be done for my work, at that time, I forget every physical discomfort. And that, it's only when you have this kind of, jisko junoon kehte hai na.
Correct.
Jab junoon hota hai, tabhi aap kuch kar paate hai.
And when you use that word junoon, I hear that there's some Twitter activity that you're extremely sort of investing a lot of time and resource, something on Shairi. Tell me something about it. I just vaguely sort of overheard that.
So in 2011, when I was living in the Gulf, I joined Twitter in 2009. And then I used to feel very, miss home a lot. And I started, we made friends. We were small groups at that time. And Twitter was very different from what it is now. That time it was more of cultural. Today it's become very political. So I joined groups of people who were interested in Urdu Shairi. And then one day I said, why not make a group in which a hashtag in which we have dedicated verses. So that is 2011 April, now 2020. It's still running 24/7. People have called it a 24/7 Mushaira. So every week on Sunday, I make a schedule. Like today, for the word of the day for today is Bijli. So we are doing a theme. We do theme based. So today, this week's theme is monsoon. On Sunday, we were experiencing rains. So today is Bijli. So everybody is tweeting verses on Bijli. And we include all verses, whether it is Hindi or Urdu. And one day, Sunday, we have dedicated to Kavya, which is for Hindi poets. So, you know, like, it is expanding everybody's vision and knowledge. And so many people in our group who started learning. And we tweet a lot of things in that, also about poetry, etc. So many people in the group who joined us in 2011 today have become poets themselves. So that, I feel, is a very big achievement for
me. Huge, of course. Congratulations. Because I think these are the smaller... And when you say that, just coming back to Murshidabad, so we have... So what we are doing as a part of our project, and as I said, the whole idea is to be extremely local. Because I can't today... I'm 5 hours from Calcutta, and I'm in rural Bengal. So I can't today take the liberty of comparing myself to developed tourist destinations of India, such as Rajasthan or the southern parts of India. And I think it's wrong also because, of course, when we are not hoteliers by profession. And so for us, is every step is a step in the unknown. And you don't even know if you're doing the right thing or if you're not doing the right thing. So at that stage, everything that we're doing is something, if it works, it's innovative. If it doesn't work, it was stupidity. So herein, what we realize that heritage to me is not only just buildings. It is far more. So I don't know if you know about this dance form. It's called Rai Beshi, which is a 500-year-old martial art-based dance form. And just to go ahead and show that to the world, to showcase that particular genre of dance, for me itself is a huge achievement. And for example, Sufi, we've got these most amazing Baul and Sufi singers. Sufi is a wrong word, but we use it for our international guests as Sufi. But Fakiri, they call themselves Fakiri artists. So these are people who do not live in the cities. These are people who are happy in the ruralist parts of Bengal with bare minimum infrastructure. And you have to see their talent. And the best thing is because what we request all these performers who come in, especially the Fakiri ones, they translate the music. They translate the words, and it is wonderful for us. So what we do is we write little books on these, so which we can hand out to our guests. Because even if it's a different language, till the time you understand what they're saying beforehand, then you start enjoying the music tremendously. So all of these, you know, small shairis that come in two parts of that. And I distinctly remember this particular Fakiri song where it says that this singer, he said, allow me to a king, saying that allow me my music. What can your music do? My music can bring the skies down and lift the earth, so that when they combine, that is the moment of bliss. So this is the and you know, for people who appreciate shairi, it has so much of depth in these lines. So I've now truly become a big fan of this genre of music.
And you've convinced me that as soon as the lockdown and the coronavirus is over, I am coming over to Murshidabad.
You are absolutely. Once we have this conversation, you automatically become a de facto guest for Bari Kothi. We'd love to host you.
Thank you.
Tell us, I also traced a little bit more, and Divya from our team, she shared this information that this the family background.
So we have a lot of traditions and a lot of traditional stuff. As I said, my ancestors came from Iran in the 14th and 15th century. They came to India and they settled here. My maternal family is from Jaunpur. My paternal family is from Aligarh. And we have a lot of history in our family. So, growing up, we took all these things for granted. And you're talking of restoring your Kothi. We have, my husband, he has a house which was built in 1830. It's near Farukhabad. And that's falling to pieces. all the, in fact, all the Havelis, there were a group of Havelis, about six of them made each adjoining the other. All of them are now, except one, I think, is in, falling to pieces, and we don't know what to do with it. And this time when I went, I saw the beautiful tiles there, and, you know, so much there, but it's, you know, the underground tehanas, which were used in the afternoons. But all of that is now in a state which I think is beyond repair. So I'm always very happy to hear that people are conserving heritage, because this is the only thing that we can pass on to, as you said, to your daughters or to the coming generations. Because this hotel is not only going to be for your daughters, but if you're conserving music, you're conserving dance form, it is for everybody. That, so it helps everybody in India. And that's what I do with my writing. When I'm writing, I'm documenting stories. I'm documenting things that happened. I'm documenting what we have also lost. In my books, I also write about the monuments that we have lost. So that at least it's there in public memory and public domain that this is what it was and this is what it is now. And that constant comparing between the past and the present is something I have done in my book, Shahjahanabad, where I talk of the glory of the Shahjahani days. I talk of the problems now when Shahjahanabad has been declared to be an urban slum and the aspirations of the people who are living there. So I talk to a lot of, I do document a lot of oral history. So I talk to them, I ask them, what is it you understand? Now there are some who have been there for five generations, six generations, seven generations, some who come from the Mughal lineage. So all these people that I talked to them, and I've, you know, listed their problems, their aspirations, as well as a history of what the fort and the city would have been like under Shahjahan. So, you know, like, this is something very close to my heart. So I'm really happy to hear what you're doing.
You're saying Shahjahpur, you've particularly chosen that to see what Shahjah would have done to that place, is what your point of comparison is. Have I understood that correctly?
No, I have described the Red Fort and the city of Old Delhi, right, which was called Shahjahanabad, as it was then and as it is now. A comparison between, say, 17th century and today. So that has been my constant focus in my books, to describe what was there, what it is now, and what we need to do to preserve it. Because preserving heritage is not an easy task. And people today are not, most people are not able to afford it. So let's be frank about that. People who have huge havelis, they're unable to preserve it because the amount of money that is needed is not there. There was no timely intervention. Had, as I said, about our haveli in Farukabad, had we intervened, say, 50 years ago, we may have salvaged.
Was someone staying there? Is someone staying there in that haveli?
Nobody's been staying there for the past 30, 40 years.
Wow. And you don't end up going once in a while, or?
We do go. We go once in a while, but not regularly. Not as regularly as we should.
Mm-hmm. No, it is. I think a Herculean task, and I don't know where to start, because when you culture is such a big word, and today I think just to save that, because a lot of these larger companies are doing fantastic. When people talk about contribution, when people talk about CSR, when people talk about raising funds, and I see all of those. A lot of my sort of peer group. Who are sort of, you know, spending money by the dozens across in different activities to truly help. And I keep saying that, at least, and I speak for Murshidabad, for the lack of understanding of any other place as well, that, you know, this is the epicenter where help is required. Where, like, for example, in Bengal, what we say is, where in the world would you have 8 different foreign colonies who were in a 100-kilometer radius? Now, in order to, as a from a historical perspective, from an architectural perspective, like, for example, in I'm going on a tangent, but in Azimganj, which is where Bari Kothi is, our palaces have Greek and Roman architecture with Rajasthani gaddis, and we have British Darbar halls. So therein, and the roads are so narrow that our cars can't freely navigate through that. And one of our guests said, oh my God, this is like I've come to an Indian Venice. So, which is what the beauty of it is. And I wonder how many places like this, and I truly feel for the lack of a lot of knowledge in this, that there must be such hidden places across India which would be in dozens and no one knows about it.
Absolutely. See, most people, say in the 19th and 20th century, had huge havelis. People with means, I'm talking of, had huge havelis. Even people, the people who did not have so many means, would have been making, you know, places of worship and things like that. Even those are not being preserved so well as we should be able to. There's a lot of encroachment. And like say in Murshidabad, when I went to Murshidabad and I went to the Imambada there. Now that Imambada, of course, is beautifully maintained. But that Imam, when we talk of Imambadas, and I come from Lucknow and I am a Shia, so when we talk of Imambadas, we only talk of the Imambadas of Lucknow. But the Nizamiya Imambada is far, far bigger, and it's so grand. So when I went there and I went and, you know, saw the whole thing, saw the masjid, saw the part that was there for the guests to stay in, and I was awed, absolutely awed by the beauty of the Imambada. So more than the Hazar, I of course visited the Hazar Dwari Palace also. I visited all the mosques in that area and all the palaces that were there. And even Qasim Bazaar I went to.
Correct,
but
correct.
It was that Imambada and the grandeur and the simplicity of that Imambada. It's not that just the majesty of it, but the simplicity of it which touched me. And another place that I went to in Qasim Bazaar was this, I think, Rajbadi. There
That's
are two
correct.
Of them there.
That's
one has been preserved and one is, you know, like in shambles. We went inside that. I cannot tell you how much pain I felt when I went inside and I saw the statue of the founder there and all around him, you know, tall grasses and weeds and, you know, sitting there just all alone. And I, you know, I, as you say now, with that, how I, the name I kept, where stone speak, at that time his statue was speaking to me. And I just can't tell you what I felt that over there, that this place, say 200 years ago, would have been bustling with activity. It would have been such a fantastic, such a beautiful place. And which is Rang Mahal, where his statue is. वहाँ पे क्या-क्या नजारे होते होंगे. Now the roof has fallen, there's only grass everywhere, mud, you know, it shattered me. So these are, and I said, there was a caretaker and I said, why don't you turn it into a hotel? Because if you give it to somebody, they'll restore the property. It is just so majestic, so beautiful, and so desolate. So
You mentioned this particular, I'm interrupting, please. But it's very close to my heart again, because in Qasim Bazaar, there are two of them. And you're obviously, you're extremely well-traveled and you would know exactly the difference between the two. And this broken down palace is, it literally is, I think, the most magnificent architecture that I see in the entire region. The arches have the most beautiful work in it. And as you rightly said, that there are two of these statues also that I see around in the doorway. What beautiful sculpture. It's just mind-blowing, and we are trying our best. In fact, I happen to also be a part of this organization called the Murshidabad Heritage Development Society. We are trying to, you know, excite people. A lot of people are looking at our project to see, because no one believes commercials. Because at the end of the day, unfortunately in life, we've got this one bizarre measure of everything, which is money. So everything goes and stops around there. And I completely understand and respect that. So we are trying our best in which way we can try and devise, excite people to, and devise plans which we can present to them of how you can do what you can do. Because one part, people who have money don't have the interest. People who have the interest don't have the money. So it becomes such a catch-22 situation. And you'd be surprised, there are so many places in around Bengal, Orissa, that are now coming in. We've got the Belgaria Palace, you know, they've got fantastic work and opening, because I strongly feel the only way there's a difference between the living heritage and the dead heritage. And you can restore it once, and, you know, one generation can have a lot of money who comes in and makes a lot of, work in there. But maybe, you know, a generation or two generations later, it's all gone. And the only way you can sort of make that heritage live for longer is your ability to make it sustainable. And for which
absolutely.
I think one, of course, a part of it is community and all of that, which is absolutely the core of it. But the other is the business associated with it. So be it a cultural center, be it a hotel, be it a museum. In Murshidabad, you've got the absolutely fantastic Kadgola palace.
Yes, I visited that also.
And Sanjay uncle, he's done a magnificent job. That if you see pictures from 20 years back, and that palace has been, I know, I'll take the liberty of, and I, since you're a storyteller also, I'll take the liberty of sharing the story. So the story of Kathgola Palace is one of Sanjay uncle's dadaji's were in London, and he was roaming around on the streets there, and he saw one of these, you know, stores of these artifacts, and he walked in there, and he was wearing his dhoti and being typically dressed. He walked in and he said, "What's the price of this article? What's the price of this article?" And the salesman who was there, he went ahead and probably mentioned four or five prices. Then he said that, "I hate these Indians. You know, they'll ask all these prices for everything, and I bet he can't buy the cheapest thing." And as the other part of the story is fairly predictable, he goes ahead and he says that, "Please, can I meet your owner?" And he tells the owner, "I would like to buy your entire store. And with two conditions, it has to be shipped within 2 months, 3 months. And the other is, this gentleman here who I was talking to has to personally come and install it in my outhouse and my garden house." So Kathgola Palace, in fact, is that garden house and outhouse, which has everything from that one store. And it is what we understand from the family who owns it, is it has been robbed at least 10 times, but still has enough things to make it one of the most successful museums privately run in Bengal. So it is magnificent what people have been, but the idea entirely is to make it sustainable. And that, I think, is the biggest challenge.
So as I said, Kathgola, again, very beautiful, the temple attached to it, all very beautiful. And see, the story that you told me, this is the kind of story I would tell in my book. I do tell in my books, when I'm talking about it, I talk about the history of the owners, what did they go through, what did they do, and this is what then makes the stones come alive. Because if you're just going to give dimensions that, you know, this Kathgola Palace, it has so many columns, it has so many windows, it has, it's this high and that wide, and, you know, foundation, nobody is going to be interested. But any human interest story, which is of course a fact-based human interest story, comes into the picture, and then, you know, everybody's attention is attracted to that. Correct. And then when you go there, then you want to, you associate with it. And this is the best way to get youngsters interested in heritage. Yes.
Absolutely. And I think I was interrupting with just that statement, because the moment you make it interesting for a person, one is where someone has an ownership on their asset, but the other is how do you get that interest? So, for example, my sister, she got a part of the, she became a, now is a, like, one of the central part of the project. For her also, it started with just listening to these stories. And then the human mind is just marvelous, where you can fantasize. And you can then go into the deepest part of history, fantasize every bit of it. So every room we've done in Bari Kothi is something that we've tried to dedicate to one of our ancestors, so that they come alive and their memories live on. And we can talk about
that. That's a beautiful homage.
And when you do that, and suddenly my sister's like, "Oh, I didn't know Buri Dadi was so beautiful," or "I didn't know Buri Dadi was so charming." So we're into the silk business. So there's a little bit more of an interest in silk and textile and all of that. So this is where the projects become more exciting. And then everyone becomes a part of it. And that, I think, has now become a central part, in my naive and humble opinion, about restoration. And about, because you can always get the fanciest architect and they can do all of it, but how do you keep it alive?
And also, how do you keep the sensibility alive? Because when you're restoring, you have to restore it with the same vision that was in the original builder's mind. You know, I've seen some restorations which are horrendous, because they bring in something totally new into an old building. And you know, another story I'll share with you in my first book, Where Stones Speak, and where I've described the Qutub Minar. Now, with the Qutub Minar, of course, everybody knows it was built in 1196. But in 1800, in the beginning of the 19th century, I think it was 1803 or something, there was an earthquake. And part of the Qutub Minar was damaged, especially the balconies and the top, top part of it. So there was this British engineer called Robert Smith, who was given the charge of repairing it. Now, when he repaired it, if you, anybody who's seen the Qutub Minar, they'll see that the balconies are very utilitarian. They do not go at all with the squinches and the rest of the mukarnas and the beautiful architecture that is there. Smith also made this on top. He made a flagstaff tower, which he thought must have been, of course, he must have thought it was very beautiful. That's why he added it to the top of the Qutub Minar. And people started making fun of it. And then Lord Hardinge had to, you know, get it taken off. It's still kept in the Qutub Minar complex because it just did not go with the rest of the architecture. He brought something very colonial into it. And it was called, I'm forgetting the name. Just give me a second. I'll tell you what it was called. They called it... you know, people started making salt and cellar sets like that. It was because it looked like a salt and pepper set. So that's what they started getting making. And as I said, that Hardinge was, he called it Strawberry Hill Gothic.
Strawberry Hill Gothic.
Gothic. Now, Strawberry Hill Gothic does not go with a monument that has been made in the 12th century or the 13th century. So that's why I said that when we are restoring, even today when you see restoration, when it's being done to something from the 18th or 19th century, we have to give it modern conveniences. Of course, you need air conditioning, you need piping, etc., which would not have been there, modern toilets. But you have to do it within the same sensibility, and I'm sure you must have done that only, of whatever the building was. Just, you know, like naturally grow into it instead of growing some, adding something which is jars.
Right, and the biggest, I know, if you, in your experience also with restoring old buildings, I don't know if you found this common problem, but there's a lot of you go to structural engineers, you have restoration architect, you have architects who will come in and who will tell you about things, but then when you, the architect will always sort of try and guide you once to take that stamp and dhabba from you know, a structural engineer that, oh, this is going to be stable. We consulted so many of these, and a lot of people went ahead and they told us that there is no chance you can make this survive. And for us, the greatest challenge was, and hats off and like to just thank our architect, who then just said that, hey, you know what, there has to be common sense and logic in everything. And we'll have to address that. And he very simply saved that entire building for us just by ensuring he had these steel girders that went all the way down. He sort of brought them up all the way, wrapped it with chicken mesh, and he said, you want the structure to be alive, I'll make sure it's alive. And he wrapped it around, he held it tight, and now the structure, at least he said, I'm giving you a guarantee of 50 years. After 50 years, I'll be dead. You can't come and hit me, but at least you won't curse me. So at least he's given me that guarantee, but we've tried to keep that alive. And a large part, what I also realized is the soul, what you, I think, rightly said, you know, that entire, the period, or you know, you can't suddenly add a different tinge to it.
Huh. And you have to keep the design intention of the original builder, because that is what is the beauty of it. So you keep adding conveniences, but it has to be added as per, you know, whatever the existing ethos is of, and the culture is of the place. So I'm very happy to hear about that. In fact, you know, when I came to Murshidabad 2018, and at that time I was told that, you know, there are only very small hotels here. And so I'm glad that you built a heritage hotel for people who come there. I forget the name of the place I stayed, but I stayed in a very small hotel there.
I don't believe, see, the point is, we've tried to, we now, my target is at least in 5 years, I need to have 100 suites, 100 rooms in that entire region. Because till the time we don't make it, we get such interesting queries of people wanting to come from England, and they want to land in Calcutta, hop onto the boat and take a 3-night cruise, get to Kazimganj, and they get onto our water jetty, they stay with us and have a little, you know, 3-day function, a wedding function or whatever in there, and they take the train, a 4-hour train ride, and go back. And at this point in time, I realized that I can only, we have 15 suites. So we can only accommodate 30 odd people, 35 at max with triple sharing. However, if I had 100 rooms with the assets that Murshidabad has, And, you know, one of we end up calling, we try to get a lot of bloggers because we learn a lot from them. Our dear friend Tanesh, who's right here, sent in a few comments also over here. So Tanesh is also, you know, trying to promote heritage, etc. And he will sort of second me on this. The amount of assets that Murshidabad has, I can see a lot of places in India.
Absolutely.
We've tried to get UNESCO to come in, and they said, oh, you've got your own cuisine, you've got your own dialect, you've got the river, you've got all those check boxes that have to be done are all ticked mark. But the intention, the political will and the political intent to promote these places, and as a private organization, you can only do so much. So that becomes a little bit of a challenge, but hopefully we'll be able to attract all of these people. There are humble accommodations now. Mr. Amarnath, who's, I think, a fantastic example of how to convert and make restoration come alive with his projects, Nimrana Properties. I think he's done incredible. We tried to get him on board, adopt a few of these. We've got the government excited. The government's now trying to, one of the palaces which is under them, they're looking to convert that into a 60-room hotel. So maybe in about a few years, you'll see a lot of change and you'll be happy with Murshidabad.
And I think next year is when I will be coming.
Yes.
And
yes,
the boat cruise sounds so exciting. You know, when we went to Egypt, I took the Nile cruise. And I kept thinking, we've got the Ganga in India. With, mm-hmm. you know, like if you have a cruise, say a week-long cruise along the Ganges, whether it's in Banaras or whether it's near Calcutta, you will have so many heritage buildings all along, because people did build on the riverfront. And that is something that should be developed. And yet, we have not developed river tourism as yet. And you are saying that there is a 3-day boat journey from Calcutta to Murshidabad.
Well, to be honest, there are multiple river cruises from Assam, Bengal to Heritage Exotic to Vivada. So now Pandor Cruises is also coming. So there are 4 leading cruise liners that are already operating between Calcutta and Murshidabad. And they do a 7-night, 11-night, 13-night, depending on everything.
Wonderful.
And they typically, for example, Pandor and Heritage Exotic, all of them, they have primarily international bookings. So they would essentially give the comforts of Europe inside their cruises, but they would stop over and go into the villages, do a village walk. They would come and spend maybe 5 hours at Bari Kothi, see one of the Fakiri performances, hear the Sherwali story, do all of that, and hop off. So the idea is to give everyone that comfort because you don't have accommodations. Yeah. Similarly, Assam, Bengal, they're doing a magnificent work again, pioneers again in what they're doing. And from that, you know, and since you've been to Hazardwari, sitting on the banks of the Ganges, just imagine if you're on the middle of the river, overlooking that magnificent palace. I think on a sunset, which is an experience they organize, I believe, I think for me, it's just, you know, talking about these things is just itself a journey for me.
You know, the reason when I started following Bari Kothi on Instagram, and then I agreed to Divya's request to come here, was a picture of your Bari Kothi with the chairs in the veranda overlooking the river. And
right.
I said, you know, this is the kind of life I want. This is the place I would love to
visit. Please, we would love to. And you know, it can be a quid pro quo. You can go through a few of our documents and you can stay with us as long as you want.
I'm coming over. Don't worry. Because Murshidabad, again, is a place which is very rich in documents, especially documents in Farsi. As yet, as I said, I'm still learning Farsi. I'm not that proficient. But there must be scholars who do know. And there is so much of history in Murshidabad that needs to be explored. And that has not been explored as yet. There are a couple of books which have been written on Murshidabad, but those were written, I think, in the 20th century, 19th and 20th century. And you need to study that period, because Murshidabad and, say, the Nawabs, they have been very instrumental. in the history of India. So that is something. When I went there, I met Chote Nawab over there. And he was telling me about his history. I spent some time with him in his house. He was saying that, and then this is something that has been brought out by William Dalrymple in the Anarchy, that people only keep blaming Mir Jafar, but there were many more people who were involved in that conspiracy of Plassey. You know, these are documents which should be studied. And these more and more facts should come out.
I'm interrupting on that because when you said, I think at that point in time, someone wanted a villain. And Mir Jafar was the best villain history could have. But there are so many accounts to it. And that, and not only from Chote Nawab, but, and I know when you met him, if you saw that glint in his eye, you can still feel the blood flowing. And it was just, it's absolutely fascinating to have a conversation with him every time. And for me, it is, I wish these could go out and you know, for me as one person trying to do something, it'll take some more time. And I'm, you know, it's just, we had a 5-year-old baby. For me, we've just taken birth. So we still have to make the project work for all of these other things to fit in. And one of my first things would be to exactly what you just pinpointed, that history. I don't want to use big words that it doesn't need correction, because I think that's a very big task. But at least there has to be enough content available freely online for people to understand the other side of the story.
Yes, they should. And you talk, I spent actually the entire evening with Chote Nawab. I saw the Sound and Light program with him, and then he took me to the Karbala. So, you know, that was a beautiful experience. And when I was seeing the Sound and Light, and then, of course, as you said, that Mir Jafar Ishu was a villain in that, I could feel his discomfort sitting next to me. And that's when he started opening up to me and telling me. So these are aspects which should be. Then I visited the Imam Bada over there. Now, that the small Imam Bada that is inside Mir Jafar's house.
Right.
Again, that was something that I didn't know about, that there is a relic here from Karbala. And people don't even know about it. So when I came back and I started posting pictures, people said, oh, how is this possible? You've never heard of it. I said, that is because he is somebody who's been, you know, like labeled Namak Haram. So people don't talk about him.
Correct. And which is, and another part to blame is also the region. Now, I'll tell you of another temple, since you mentioned this, very interesting. It's called Kirteshwari Temple. I understand it's from the local, the pundit who manages and the trust that manages, it's more than, it's been documented to be at least 1,000 years old. Now, I fair enough, it's 1,000, it's 500, I'm not going to that debate. For me, what is interesting is, there are shivlings which are lying on the ground, on the side, on the ground left for nobody to even look at. So when I looked at that, I had to take a picture and send it to our family group, and I said, this is the only part in the world that I know where gods are also forgotten. Had it been any other historically popular place, this would have a line of 1,000 people and a massive shrine. But when the region doesn't, and that story is also very interesting. Apparently, it was the wrath of the gods that fell upon Murshidabad because of apparently two stories. I'll take the liberty of quickly sharing that. One being of Jagat Seth. And how he asked Lakshmi ji that please stop coming to my house. And she said, after 7 generations, I will leave you completely. And my peer group now is the 8th generation. And Lakshmi ji truly has left them completely. Completely left that. And it is said that because of that, Jagat Seth's statues around Murshidabad, the entire region, because of an earthquake, all of Jagat Seth's statues fell down. Or his house, his main house, the river changed its course and his main house was eaten by the river. So that's how Jagat Seth got wiped off from history. And the other integral person was Rani Bhavani. So she apparently took an oath that I'll make 108 Shiva temples. She made 107 and the wrath of Shiva fell upon the place. And it said that nothing over here, gods will also be forgotten. You've got 200-year-old Jain temples. You've got 300-year-old mosque, the Blue Mosque. If you see, we do these heritage walks, it is mind-blowing. And I promise you, there would be a million people visiting, but everyone's forgotten about it. And that's the sad part. And I don't know what to do about it.
I visited one brick temple there. It was with the terracotta.
That's correct. That's the Rani Bhavani temple. That's the one.
No, this is not Rani Bhavani. This was near this place,
Vishnupur.
Vishnupur. I think because it's just in the middle of a village. And in fact, I wrote a story on it for the Hindu that that temple has some of the most exquisite terracotta images on it.
Correct.
I spent quite a long time, you know, like going all around it. Then the priest came, he opened it for me, and I went inside and everything. So I came back and I wrote about it in the newspaper that, you know, this is such a beautiful temple. And again, a very beautiful story also, because I believe everybody in that village, whatever religion, community, faith they are, they all together protect that particular temple, and they celebrate, I think it's a Shiva temple. So that it celebrates Shivratri, etc. Over there. So, for, you know, like any other places, I said, this temple would have been a highlight, and it would have been a part of a proper heritage program. But some of the, of course, the some of the murtis are getting defaced because of the climate and pollution, etc. We need to, you know, preserve that also. Because beautiful, and it has that tableau of that story of that Mahabali, those three steps that Lord Vishnu took. That tableau is so fantastic.
And I think that's the beauty with all of these terracotta temples, even the Rani Bhavani one, and all of these. All of them have such deep storytelling. And I wish if I had all the resources where, you know, you could document every story. And imagine when you walk in, you get this handbook where you would have, you would understand, you look at this particular picture and you're like, oh, they're trying to depict that. We saw in the Rani Bhavani terracotta temple, you see these British soldiers on the terracotta, the structures that are there. So you see all these Hindu deities that are there with the old stories, etc. And then in the last, you see British soldiers over there holding a gun. Like rifle literally positioned. And for me, it's just such deep, powerful stories that are getting depicted on the walls, which itself, I think that's your title of the book again. I'm sorry, I keep coming back to Where Stones Speak, because that's what it is. Very beautiful.
They do speak. They do
very,
speak.
Very, very beautiful.
And I think, are you talking of Baranagar?
Baranagar is the Rani Bhavani temple. That's correct.
I went there also. Right. And there were the two small temples which were totally eaten up by plants and trees and undergrowth, which again I found very beautiful. And this one wedges these four temples together.
Right.
I think it's called Char that Bangla.
That's called the Char Bangla, and the one which is two is called the Jor Bangla. And even the architecture wise, it's called that Bangla roofs are there. In fact, I know if you went till there, so Bari Kothi is a 10-minute walk from there. So, and around the cluster, you would have a lot of beautiful Jain temples with Mughal architecture. Nowhere in the world would you find Jain temples with Mughal architecture. And that itself has such a huge, and the entrance of the temple is called Nobat Khana. So that is where all these people, which inside would be Rajasthani Gaddi, you know, those timber teak wood structures, and the Shehnai Walas and the Dholak Walas would be sitting there performing their music, so that when you're entering the temple, your state of mind gets altered because of music. So it's quite amazing, and I can keep talking about it, sorry, for hours. But
I have at least placed where Bari Kothi is. If it is next to the Baranagar temple. Because I think I spent a whole day in Baranagar. And there was this one other temple, it was that the Jor temple, I don't know, which has been modernized a bit. It's right on the bank of the river.
That's been modernized a little bit. That's again just another Shiva temple. It's again got the same structural thing. Right. So that again is apparently, story goes that there are multiple of these 107 odd temples that I was mentioning. So a lot of those were there. I'm also not very, to be honest, I've not got to the bottom of it. And there's not a lot of people know. And the ones that you know that I can further speak of need to be verified by me. And which is something, again, as you said, and as you rightly, I think, identified, these are very time consuming exercises to do.
Yes, you need a lot of passion, you need a lot of time. As I said, like, I've been exploring Delhi for the past 8 years, and I've written three books, translated three on Delhi, and I've documented about 500 odd monuments in Delhi. But even then, there are some places which people keep coming up with, oh, you didn't see this, you didn't mention that, and I realize, oh, I didn't know about this. Because they are in hidden corners, some have been encroached. So, you know, like, it's not possible to reach them. But every place has so much of history, and you need some chronicler. Like, now people keep telling me, you come to this city, you write about this city, the same way you've written about Delhi. But, you know, it needs a lot of time. So, going
how long
somewhere...
is the entire journey of writing your book? Your first book, how long did it take you?
Two years.